The following is distributed by the Berean Call.
Greetings, everyone. Welcome to the third day of the Berean Call Conference. My name is Dave Kircher. I'm one of the board members for the Berean Call, and I'd like to open us with prayer. Let's do that now. Father in heaven, thank you for loving us. Thank you for providing this wonderful hope that you've provided for us, Father. Thank you for sending your Son that he might become sin for us who knew no sin, that we might become the righteousness of God in him. Thank you, Father, for authoring and preserving your word. Thank you for this opportunity to meditate together upon your word. Father, we thank you today for those who have prepared their hearts to bring forth ministry to us today. Father, we ask that as these words are presented, Father, that you would provide the increase, Lord. We thank you that we as your servants sow and we water, but you provide the increase. We pray, Father, that you would provide an increase that is beyond what we ask or think today. We ask, Father, for you to provide instruction where instruction is needed. We ask, Father, that you provide correction where that's needed. Lord, we ask that the church be edified, that we be edified, Lord, and strengthened by your might. And Lord, we would ask that the fruit and the outcome of this would be what you have purposed, Father, and that it would be accomplished according to your might working within us, that same might which raised the Lord Jesus from the dead and set him at your own right hand, far above all principality and power, might and dominion, and every name that is named, not only in this world, but in that which is to come. And it's in that name of Jesus that we make this request. Amen.
Welcome to the last day of the 2021 Berean Call Conference. Our first speaker today is Mike Warren. I first met Mike when he and I were speakers for Roger Stallhead at a conference, and I remember thinking, boy, this guy's a way better speaker than I am. So I'm very thankful to have Mike here to share with us. He's pastor of Gold Country Calvary Chapel, and his message is entitled, A Tale of Two Churches.
Well, thank you for being part of the 2021 Berean Call Conference. My name is Pastor Mike Warren. I pastor Gold Country Calvary Chapel up in Grass Valley, California. Again, I want to thank T.A. McMahon and the staff there at Berean Call for honoring me with a great privilege once again of being one of your speakers. And again, I don't consider myself a specialist. You're going to hear from a lot of those guys that will just be speaking on very specific topics and concerns of false teaching coming into the church. My job is more of a general practitioner, as it were. I'm your family doctor. I'm your pastor's perspective for this conference. And so let's just open in a word of prayer and we'll dive in. The message I felt like the Lord gave to me for you, if I would put a title to it, I would call it A Tale of Two Churches. So let's pray. Father, we thank you again for this opportunity, Lord, again, to gather together as the body of Christ, to be strengthened, to be warned, to be encouraged, and to be comforted. Again, we would pray that the Holy Spirit would take these words and plant them not just into our heads, but deep into our hearts. And we ask these things in the mighty name of Jesus. And again, all God's sons and daughters would say, amen, amen. A Tale of Two Churches. You know, as I survey the condition of the church today, as a pastor, it's very simple for me to see that there are two things that exist in the world today that are called the church, and they are diametrically opposed to each other, and I think it's extremely important at this time that we make that distinction. And so this message is going to make that distinction as best I can between what is called the church and what truly is the church in these last days. Now, Paul told us in 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, verse 3, he said that in the last days there would be a falling away, an apostasy from the biblical faith. And I think we're living in that time. I can certainly see it around me and other churches. The most important thing for us is the true body of Christ and the true followers of Christ is to stay the course. So let me just lay it out like this. There are two things. One is an organism. And listen carefully, because we are the body of Christ, what an organism looks like. The organism, which is the body of Christ, it is born again by the Spirit of God. It is empowered and led by the Spirit of God. It is built upon that sure foundation and that solid foundation of God's Word, God's inspired Word, His authoritative Word, His inerrant Word. It's like it tells us in Ephesians chapter 2, you know, we're built upon that foundation of the apostles and the prophets, Jesus Christ Himself being the chief cornerstone, in which He is the head and we are members of His body, and it's a living relationship. You know, 2 years ago, I had the wonderful privilege of traveling to Asia Minor and visiting the seven churches that are recorded there in the book of Revelation. And it was very interesting when we came to Antioch, Syria, and we were in that little cave church where it was purported that the Holy Spirit, as we read in Acts, the Holy Spirit said to those elders gathered as they were ministering to the Lord and as they were praying, the Holy Spirit said, separate Barnabas and Paul unto the work that I've called them to. And they laid hands on them, prayed them, and sent them out under the power of the Holy Spirit. And when you read through the book of Acts, the church, the early church, the first church, the true church, was completely led and directed of the Holy Spirit. In fact, I also got to visit Antioch Pisidia up there in the mountains where when Paul arrived and he was seeking to move on in his ministry, you know, he was seeking to go up into Bithynia to go north, and the Holy Spirit said no. He then sought to go south toward Ephesus. The Holy Spirit again said no. Just keep going in the direction you're going, and further instructions will come, as it were. And there he had that vision of the Macedonian man, and for the first time, the gospel leaves Asia Minor and moves over into Europe. all of that led and directed of the Holy Spirit. A.W. Tozier tells us that if you would have taken the work of the Holy Spirit out of the first century church, out of the book of Acts, as it were, 90% of what we read would have never happened. But then he goes on to say, but if you took the work of the Holy Spirit, that leading and guiding, that directing, as we followed Jesus out of the modern church, 90% of what goes on would go on unaffected. And that's tragic. So one is an organism. And again, let me just say, it's the body of Christ, born of the Spirit, empowered by the Spirit, led of the Spirit, directed by the Holy Spirit, built upon the solid foundation of God's inerrant, inspired, authoritative word, in which Christ is the head and we are members of his body, and it is a living relationship. The other thing that exists in the world today that's called the church is an organization with its religious system, driven and controlled by men, built upon the foundation of man's philosophy, his methodology, his ideology, in which man is the head and the people's opinions are the rule. And it is just a dead system of religion. These two things exist today, and both of them, by the way, are being called the church. Now, the best way I can find to illustrate this this difference between an organism and an organization is found in Revelation chapter 3 as Jesus writes to the last two churches of those seven churches that he sent those epistles to. And it's interesting as we come to these last two churches, the first being the church of Philadelphia and the second being the church of Laodicea, that the meaning of their names alone speak volumes. The church of Philadelphia. Philadelphia means brotherly love. Love is a fruit of the Spirit. Love, joy, peace, long-suffering, gentleness, kindness, meekness, self-control. Against such there is no law. And they that are Christ have crucified, as it were, these affections, these lusts, these inordinate desires, and they serve and follow Jesus Christ. And what's interesting, as we look at this church in detail in a few moments, we're going to see that this church was birthed of the Spirit. It was led of the Spirit. It was control of the Holy Spirit. It bore the fruits of the Spirit out in its ministry. And so you have the Church of Philadelphia, but right alongside that, as we're moving into these last two churches, is the Church of Laodicea. And it's interesting, the very title means people rule. It is a work of the flesh. Again, it's not an organism. It's not that body of Christ born of the Spirit. It's that work of the flesh led by man and by man's efforts. So, and it's interesting as we come now to this, as Jesus is dealing with these seven churches, he follows somewhat of a pattern that I think is important for us to make note of during this time in this teaching. The first thing is that he mentions from chapter 1, where we have that description of the risen Christ in all of his glory, in all of his majesty, he borrows some of that description as he introduces himself and what he needs to say to each one of these churches. Secondly, he gives to them a commendation for what they're doing right if something can be found that is noteworthy. The third thing he does is he corrects those things that need to be corrected. If there's something going on in that church that is wrong, that's incorrect, then he gives a correction to that. And then the fourth thing, he gives a cure. He never corrects without giving a cure. He gives a cure to those things that need to be corrected. And then he offers a reward or a blessing for the obedience in correcting those things. So let's take a look at the Church of Philadelphia first, and we'll just start our reading in Revelation chapter 3, verse 7. And to the angel of the Church of Philadelphia write, these things saith he that is holy, he that is true, he that has a key of David, he that openeth and no man shutteth, and shutteth and no man openeth. I know thy works. Behold, I have set before thee an open door, and no man can shut it. For thou hast a little strength, and hast kept my word, hast not denied my name. Behold, I will make them of the synagogue of Satan, which say that they are Jews, and are not, but they do lie. Behold, I will make them to come and worship before thy feet, and to know that I have loved thee. Because thou hast kept the word of my patience, also I will keep thee from the hour of tribulation that shall come upon all the world to try them that dwell upon the earth. Behold, I come quickly. Hold fast that which thou hast, and let no man take thy crown. To him that overcometh will I make him a pillar in the temple of my God, and he shall go out no more, and I will write upon him the name of my God, the name of the city of my God, the new Jerusalem, which cometh down from heaven, from God, and I will write upon him a new name. He that hath an ear, let him hear what the Spirit is saying unto the churches. Jesus, as John is listening to those very words and putting pen to paper under the inspiration of the Holy Spirit, is literally, these things are being dictated, as it were, from the very mouth of Christ through the heart of Paul, right out his hand onto a pen of paper for us to read these many centuries later. He introduces himself to this particular church, the church of Philippi, the church of brotherly love, that church that is controlled of the Spirit, that's bearing forth the fruits of the Spirit. He introduces himself to this church as the one who is holy, the one who is true. And those two particular descriptions have the sense of being altogether righteous and pure, altogether genuine, sincere, and authentic. This church was an authentic church. And what Christ wants from us today is to be authentic. It's interesting that in the Greek, the word for sincere means without wax. You know, in those days when people made their living making sculptures, sometimes you could work for months, you know, with a piece of marble, and you're chipping away, you know, making whatever imagery that your client hired you to do. And as you get to the very end and you're just kind of working on the final details, sometimes as they chipped away, a part or a piece would fall off. Sometimes a nose, an ear, part of a lip. And so what they would do is that they would mix wax with some of the marble dust, and then they would reform that piece and stick it on, and they would sell that particular product in a wintertime when the wax would remain hard. And then when the summer came and it began to heat up, then that particular statue or whatever they, you know, chiseled out for you, that wax would begin to soften and it would begin to lose its form. And that became to be known as something that wasn't sincere. Wasn't sincere. Here Jesus presents himself as he introduces himself to this church by being holy and true, genuine, authentic, sincere. Then he says something very interesting, because he doesn't borrow this from chapter 1. This is something that's inserted in the introduction of himself to this particular church, which I think is very interesting. He says it's that he is the one who opens and no man shuts. We're going to see as we move through this message that this is the church of the open door, but that he opens and no man shuts. And this phrase comes from Isaiah chapter 22, verses 15 through 23. And listen to the context of it. And listen to the scenario around it and what is being said in it. It says this, starting in Isaiah 22, verse 15, "Thus saith the Lord God of hosts, go get thee unto the treasurer, even Shibna, that is over the house," that is the house of David, "and bring this message to him." We're going to see in a few moments that corruption came into the treasurer, Shibna, of the house of David. And the job of the treasurer was to take out from the supply house and deliver it to the people and minister to their needs. And Shibna became corrupt, as we're going to see. And so he sends this messenger, the Lord does, to Shibna, and he asks several questions. Listen to what he says. "What hast thou here? What are you doing here? And who do you have here? What is going on? And who have you invited into this place? Thou hast hewn out, as it were, a sepulchre here." There's something dead. There's something that stinks here. "And thou hast hewn out for themselves a sepulchre in the high places. You've graven an habitation in the rocks." And then he says this, "Behold, the Lord will carry thee away with a mighty captivity and will surely cover thee. He will surely violently turn and toss thee like a ball into a large country. And of course, we know this as when Nebuchadnezzar laid siege to Jerusalem, and those because they didn't listen to the warnings of the prophets, they were led into captivity into Babylon. Here's the warning of God to this particular person, Shibna. Thou shalt die there, there in thy chariots, and the glory shall be of the shame of the house of Israel. I will drive thee from thy station. I'm going to remove you from that position. And from the state shall he pull thee down. From that position and from that state that you once were placed in, because you have not been faithful, because you've allowed false things and idolatry to creep in, God says, I'm going to remove you from that position and from that place. And it shall come to pass in that day that I will call my servant Eliakim, who is the son of Hilkiah, and I will clothe him with a robe. And that's one of the things we're promised when we get to heaven, is we're going to be given a robe, the robe of righteousness. And he says, then I will strengthen him with the girdle. He will be girded with truth. I will strengthen him with truth. And I will commit thy government, the authority, into his hand. And he shall be a father. He shall be like a shepherd to the inhabitants of Jerusalem and even unto the house of Judah. He will be my representative, because it's relational. As a father to their children, as the heavenly father to us, his sons and daughters, this Eliakim will take up that position of shepherding and ministering to Jerusalem and to the house of Judea. And listen, here goes. And the key of the house of David will I lay upon his shoulders. He's the one who will go into the storehouse and bring out the things that are necessary, the things that are right. So shall he open, and no man shall shut. And he shall shut, and no man shall open. And I will fasten him, get this, I will fasten him as a nail in a sure place, and he shall be for a glorious throne to his father's house. So as Jesus introduces himself to this church of Philadelphia, he borrows from an Old Testament scenario, part of that situation, and some of the verbiage there to remind us, if we are the church of the living God, born of the Spirit, led of the Spirit, controlled of the Spirit, empowered by the Spirit, if we are that church that is standing firm on the authoritative Word of God, not compromising, if we truly are those that are in relationship with Christ, then God will give to you and me an open door. And there's three things I want to look at in this message about that open door. Number one, Hebrews chapter 4, verse 16. And this is my favorite. This is my absolute favorite open door in all of God's Word. I spend a lot of time accessing this particular door. I have a kind of a policy and kind of a thing that I do, and I do it a lot, and I do it often, where I just go up into the mountains and I'll spend a day and a night and the next part of the next day just in prayer and fasting. And I'll do it at least a couple times a month. Because I know that my walk with the Lord is relational. And to develop that relationship, to cultivate that relationship, to keep that relationship current and intimate, it takes time and it takes effort. And I know that I just have to get away from all of the busyness. I have to get away from all of the noise, as it were, all of those things clamoring for my attention. And I have to get into a place, and for me, it's up in the mountains. You can find your own place. I have to get away so I can just spend time with the Lord, because he's given to us an open door. It's an invitation, as it were. And listen to what it says in Hebrews chapter 4, verse 16. Let us therefore come boldly unto the throne of grace. You know, those times when I'm just sitting alone and I'm praying, it just feels like his presence envelops me. I hear his voice, and often I've told our congregation, and they'll kind of laugh a little bit, it's not like I'm insane and I'm hearing voices. The voice I hear is much louder than any physical voice, although it resides in my heart. That's where the Holy Spirit has taken up residency. And he invites me, he says, you can come boldly into the very throne room of grace that you might obtain mercy and find grace and help in a time of need. They that wait upon the Lord renew their strength, man. They mount up with wings of eagles, they run and they don't grow weary, and they walk and they don't pass out or faint. Listen, this open door that we have as the true church is a door open right into his very throne room. It's that place where we receive our strength and our encouragement, as it were, our marching orders. It's where we get direction. It's those places where we are comforted, we're encouraged, and sometimes corrected. Many times I'm up in the mountains and, you know, my procedure is always to start praying for our church and for the needs of our church, but it's not long, just a few minutes, and it comes right back up on me, on my heart. You know, because as goes the pastors, as go the churches. And so we have an open door to our Father. And number two, we have an open door ministry. In Colossians chapter 4, verse 3, Paul says, pray for us that God would open unto us a door of utterance, that we should speak the mysteries of Christ, for which I am in bonds, who I'm a prisoner of. And we know that the Lord answered this prayer, because when Paul arrives in Ephesus, he says, effectual and fervent door of ministry was open unto me here at Ephesus. And one of the ways I knew that is because of the resistance. My adversaries are many. Listen, just because God opens a door for the true church of ministry in this world, it does not mean there's not going to be resistance. In fact, you can count on it. In fact, the way Paul knew there was an open door of ministry for him there in Ephesus is because his adversaries were many. Again, I got the wonderful privilege of being in that theater a couple years ago in Ephesus. You know, walk down the pathway that led to the theater, and I could but think Paul standing out there as, you know, the whole city of Ephesus came out to cry with a loud voice, "Great is Diana of the Ephesians," trying to oppose the gospel that was coming into that city. But they couldn't stop it, because we know that they burned all their books of witchcraft, and I got to be in that marketplace as well, just as they were coming to faith in Christ. So not only do we have an open door and access to our Heavenly Father, that we might cultivate that intimate relationship. And by the way, Jesus modeled this. How often do we read in the Gospels where he sent his disciples away? He sent the multitude and the crowds away, and he would just go up into a high place or to a mountain to spend time with his Father. If Jesus thought it necessary to do that, how much more do we need that? So you have an open door of access to the Father. You have an open door of ministry. Doesn't mean there won't be difficulty, but we have an open door of ministry. And again, the last one I want to mention as we're going through this study is Revelation chapter 4, verse 1. We have an open door to heaven. In fact, it says in Revelation chapter 4, and I believe here John is speaking of the rapture. It's the promise that God gave us in John chapter 14. When he said, let not your hearts be troubled. And hey, look around today, man. Do not let your heart be troubled. You know, we're getting closer and closer to the coming of Christ for his bride. Let not your heart be troubled. In my Father's house are many dwelling places. If it weren't so, I would have told you. Now listen, I go away to prepare a place for you, that where I am, you might be also. And if I go away, this is the promise, I will come again to receive you unto myself, that where I am, you might be also. And so one of these days, we're going to hear, as it were, the shout of the trumpet, you know, as the archangel sounds that time for us to come home. I think we're going to hear those words come up hither, and I'm going to show you the things that are going to take place after this. But John says, and after this, I looked, and behold, there was a door opened into heaven. This church of Philadelphia is relational. This church of Philadelphia has a promise from the Father that they are citizens of heaven and not of this earth. They're just passing through. This church needs to be effective when it's passing through. It needs to be led of the Spirit, directed of the Spirit. It needs to bring as many people to faith as it possibly can, but it's empowered by the Spirit. This church is relational. This church has been given by the power of the Holy Spirit a ministry, and it's been given a promise one day that we're going to leave this life and make heaven our home. Now, when it comes to the commendation for this church, listen to what he says, I know thy works. And this is a very interesting statement, because it's not, I know thy works experientially. It's not that I'm just watching. I know your works from a very interesting word in the Greek, oida, which means I know not only what you do, not just what I see you doing, but I know the heart and the motivation behind it. And so as the Lord addresses this particular church, he says, I know. I know what it's cost you to stand. I know the difficulty of friends and family members that have left because you've stood. I know what it's cost you to stand. I know your works. And I know that you have but a little strength. You know, I'm glad he says that, because there's days where I feel like I have no strength. But we know the source of our strength. In fact, in 2 Corinthians chapter 12, verse 9, here's what Paul said. You remember that because of the great revelation God gave him and the ministry that was committed to him, you know that God allowed Satan, or a messenger of Satan, to buffet him. And, you know, of course, we can surmise what that buffeting was, but here's what Paul says about it. He prayed, as we know, three separate occasions that the Lord would remove that from him. And this is the answer that he gets. Listen carefully. My grace is sufficient for thee. Paul, listen. What I have given to you is sufficient. I know that you don't like the buffeting. I know you don't like this tin stake driven through you. I know that you don't like whatever it is. It could have been his eyes. Some say it was his eyes. Some say it was all the beatings he'd taken in his body. Others think it was the just constant reminder of his past, that painful past where he persecuted Christians and literally caused some to deny the faith that he now pursues at the edge of the sword and sent some off to prison and some off to death. Some believe that every time Paul would put his head on a pillow that those imageries would come back. Satan would buffet him with his past, his painful past. It could have been that, but whatever it was, here the Lord says to Paul, my grace is sufficient. For my strength, get this, is made perfect. It comes to maturity, to completion in your weakness. You know, I tell our congregation often here that because, you know, sometimes they look at me and they think, well, you know, yeah, but, you know, you're strong and I'm weak. And no. I'm weak as any person in this church. I'm weak as any person listening to this message. I just know where the source of strength is at. And because I am weak and I know that I'm weak, that I have to rely on that work of the Spirit, that strengthening and enabling of the Spirit. You know, we just need to know that we have a source and we have to tap into that source. That's why this thing is relational. And he says, you know, in your weakness, as you cry out to me, as you seek me, as you get away in the mountains, and I hear him say, Mike, and I can say, Father. And he said, well, what do you need? Well, you already know what I need. I need you. I need your strength, especially to pastor in these last days with everything that's going on. Never had to face this stuff before. I need wisdom. I need to know what to do. I need to know what to say. I'm just your representative. I'm an under-shepherd. You're the shepherd. I need orders. I need direction. I need power. I need peace. I need wisdom. I need understanding. And because I'm weak, I get to tap into the source of all of that. My grace is sufficient for thee. For my strength is made perfect in weakness. You know, the Bible says if you lack wisdom, you can ask of the Father and he'll give it to you liberally and he won't even chide you that you didn't know. And I tell our congregation often, listen, I'm just smart enough to know. I'm just smart enough to know that I don't know. Thus, I rely on his wisdom and his strength. Good place to be. Most gladly, Paul then responds, as this thorn in the flesh is not being taken from him. He said, most gladly, therefore, will I rather glory in my infirmities. Lord, I thank you for those things you allowed to come into my life that break me, that force me to my knees, that tell me that I'm not strong in myself, but there is a source of strength that I can go to that will uphold me and uplift me, that the power of Christ may rest upon me. And so as he's given commendation to this church of Philadelphia, Jesus says, listen, I know your works. I know what it's cost you to serve me. I know the pain. I know the sense of rejection by so many. Listen, I know your works, and I know that you only have a little strength, but you understand the source of all strength. The second thing he commends them on is that you have not denied my word. Boy, do we not see that going on in the churches today. You know, there's churches even in our town that will say, we don't study doctrine. Well, we did a 9-month doctrines class here. They said, we don't study doctrine because doctrine is divisive. I had one pastor send that message to me from one of his parishioners that started coming here. We don't study doctrine because it's divisive. Well, it is divisive. I'll agree to that. It's so divisive, it separates sheep from goats and wheat from tares and the saved from the unsaved. It is divisive, but it is necessary. You can't even know who God is or who Christ is or how you're saved or what the church is about, where the church is going, or the power of the Holy Spirit without doctrine. But here he's saying, you have not denied my word. You have built your lives. You've built the life of the church on the sure and solid foundation of God's word. Listen to what we read there in Acts chapter 4, verse 29, and we'll read verse 30. As the church is being challenged in the first century, it's being challenged to stop preaching and teaching God's word under threat of the authorities of the day, the Sanhedrin. And here's what these guys said. Listen, as Peter and John are being called up for preaching the word, they said this, and now, Lord, behold their threatenings. Are we not being threatened? Have we not seen pastors being arrested, hogtied, and dragged from the pulpit in Canada? I think it's up to three now. Haven't we been fined and sued and been threatened that we cannot meet? Listen, you know, when this order came down here in California where I live from our Governor Newsom, that the churches were to shut down, I went and I looked at what his constitutional powers were concerning the state of California. And I found, as I studied those things, he did have the authority for 2 weeks under the Emergency Powers Act to shut down California if there was a pandemic. So we wanting to be lawful, we submitted to that. We shut the church down for 2 weeks. But we also read in the Constitution that on the third week, it had to reach epidemic proportions, which mean it had to overwhelm the medical communities. And we have a number of churches, nurses that attend our church. And they said, not only has it not overwhelmed us, we had three cases in our county, which is 100,000 people plus, and they're laying people off at the hospital. So it didn't meet the requirement. And on the third week, he had to go to the state Congress and get approval to keep the order in place. And he didn't. So on the third week, we just opened back up. Business as usual. Posted on the front door, the Declaration of Independence and the part of the Constitution. And we put a sign up there thanking the police officers for their support out in front of our church. They park in our parking lot. They know what we're doing, and they never shut us down. Because we're under a stronger mandate than the governors or even the president or any power or authority of man. Those words were haunting me as we shut the church down because I knew the danger of it. And I know that as Paul is writing to the Hebrews in a similar time of stress, as persecution has come and they're being scattered, he said, listen, do not neglect the assembling of yourselves together as the manner of some have, but do it all the more as you see the day of the Lord approaching. I think it's very important that we do not deny his word. His word becomes the final authority for our life. And any time the laws of this land come in contradiction to the word of God, we stand on the word of God. Listen to what these guys said. Now, Lord, check this out. Listen to their threatenings. Verse 31, but grant unto thy servants that with all boldness that we may speak thy word. And when they had prayed, the place that they were in was shaken. And all of those that were assembled there, they witnessed this, they felt this. And then again, they were filled with the Holy Spirit, and they spake the word of God with boldness. That needs to be us, man. That needs to be us. Well, the next thing he commends them on is that you haven't denied my name. That's very interesting. The word for name there is onoma. And it means everything that it represents, because name represents position and authority. And he says, you have not denied my name. In Acts chapter 4, just previous to this situation, in verse 9 through 12, we read these things. You know, because they'd healed the man at Gate Beautiful there, and so he goes leaping, as you know, into the temple precincts, and the thing was reported, and then they were arrested. And so now as they're standing before the Sanhedrin, and they're giving answer for what this thing, you know, what this thing is, here's what they say. Listen carefully. If we this day, I love the sense of humor of these guys, if we this day be examined of the good deed done to the impotent man, oh, that's what we're here, you know, being accused of? The crime is doing good? Isn't that silly today that the crime for the churches are being open is doing good, that's ministering to the mental, emotional, and spiritual needs of people? Have you noticed that suicide has exponentially gone off the scale? People need to be ministered to. And so they're saying, listen, are we being tried this day for doing good, especially to this impotent man? By what means he is made whole? Be it known unto you all and all the people of Israel that by the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, whom you crucified, whom God raised from the dead, even by him doth this man stand before you whole. This is the stone which was set at naught by the builders, which became the head of the corner. Neither is there salvation in any other, for there is no other name under heaven given among men whereby you must be saved. I think that's pretty bold. And I think we need that same kind of boldness. So the commendation is, you haven't denied my word and you haven't denied my name. In fact, it's interesting, as he moves through this commendation, he comes to the next one and he says, and I know you have kept the word of my patience. What in the world? The word? Well, it literally means the testimony of my suffering. You have kept, you have guarded, you have promoted and proclaimed the testimony of my suffering. Now, what does that mean? Because this is being under attack today by the emergent church and some of these false teachers that are saying that what Jesus did on the cross did not pay for sin, because God doesn't punish sin, you see. Oh, they'll say that Jesus was crucified. They'll say that he was crucified by the Romans under, you know, Jewish law and all of those things, but it had no effect on us spiritually. You see, they've rejected the substitutionary atoning work of Christ on Calvary's cross for the remission of sins. We in this church believe that it's Christ and Christ alone that saves. It's the blood of Christ that washes us of all of our sins. And by one sacrifice, as it says in Hebrews chapter 10, by one sacrifice, listen, he made us holy, and our sins and our iniquities he remembers no more. That is a work of Christ on the cross, and we keep that message ever before us. In fact, you know, we have communion, had it last Sunday. And listen to what Paul says in 1 Corinthians chapter 11, verse 25, concerning communion. It's that place where we remember. In fact, did not Jesus say, as we're going to read in a few moments, as often as you do this, do it in remembrance of me. Remembrance of what? Of his death, of his suffering, of his sacrifice, of his love. That he was beaten and bruised for our iniquities, that he shed his blood for the remission of our sins. And that's why it says in 1 Corinthians 11:25, this is the New Testament in my blood. This cup is the New Testament in my blood. This do ye. We're commanded to do it. And as often as we drink it, we are to remember him. And so we remember that it's not by works. It's not by being good. It's not by humanitarian things. It's not by anything, no effort of our own. You know, I tell our congregation here often, there is no meritorious action whatsoever that you have committed that would garner you God's love. Listen, that would save you. You are saved by grace through faith, that not of yourself. It's a gift from God. When you bowed your heart's knee to the Lordship of Jesus Christ and you invited him into your heart and you confessed that you were a sinner in need of a Savior, you were born again of the Spirit. And as you were born again of the Spirit, God gave you a very special gift. He gave to you the gift of eternal life. And that gift came to you by faith through grace. And so it's relational. And then he gives them the promises. After the commendation, there is no correction in this church. That's interesting. But he does give them a promise of reward. Listen to several of them. I put four down here. Number one, I'm going to keep you from the hour of tribulation. That's why we are pre-trib here, not pre-trouble. We think trouble might be coming, but we are pre-trib. We believe Jesus is going to come for his bride before this tribulation begins, this time of absolute judgment of God when his wrath is being poured out for that 7 years after the rapture of the church. But we're going to be kept from the hour of tribulation. Number two, we're to hold fast to that which we have and let no man take your crown. We're going to be given the Stephanos, the victor's crown. You know, Paul said at the end of his life when he writes to Timothy in his second letter there, he says, listen, I fought a good fight. You know, I finished the course. I never gave up. I defended the faith, and now was laid up for me the Stephanos, the victor's crown. We're going to get that victor's crown. You know, the thing about wearing the victor's crown, every time Jesus comes in, you got to cast it off your head, and this, it would seem from the scripture, magically it reappears, so you got this motion going on all the time, you know, casting your crown before his feet. Somebody ought to write a song or name a band, Casting Crowns. That would be a good one, because that's what we're going to be doing when we get to heaven. Thirdly, I will make you a pillar. This is interesting. In the temple of my God. This is not a pillar that holds something up. This is more of a monument. And your name will be written on a monument in the temple of our God, that you remain faithful, that you didn't deny his name nor his word. Though no matter what it cost you, you were willing to pay the price to walk through that. Because you were born from above, filled with the Spirit. And you settled your life upon the authoritative word of God. And then he warns them, listen, behold, I come quickly. I'm coming back, and I'm coming back soon. And that's a promise, man. How many can't wait for the Lord to return? And so there's no correction for this church, and there's no need of repentance. It's what God wants the church to look like. He wants it to be an organism, not an organization. He wants it to be born from above, that work of the Spirit. He wants it to be empowered by the Spirit. He wants it to be led and guided by the Spirit. He wants it to build upon the firm foundation of God's Word, uncompromisingly so. We're an organism, not an organization. Now we come to the church of Laodicea. And again, I just want to remind you, the very name means people rule. It's not the Holy Spirit in control. It's people. It's not an organism. It's an organization. You know, Jesus said that my sheep hear my voice and they follow no other. This church, as it were, is not hearing the voice of Christ. That's why all the false teaching can come into the church. They've set aside the Word of God. They set aside solid biblical doctrine. And they substituted it with men's opinions, their ideologies, their philosophies, their methodologies. And so as Jesus introduces himself to this particular church of Laodicea, where the people are in control and the people rule, the first thing he brings to the fore is that he is the Amen. And I like that. There's been some controversy lately about Amen. Remember the guy in Congress prayed Amen and a woman? That's not at all what it means. Amen simply means verily or so be it, which speaks of his immutability. That what God said will always be what God said. He doesn't change his mind. There is no shadow of turning in him. And if I hear one more time that, listen, the Bible is not culturally relevant. You see, it was written for times long ago, and it doesn't fit our society. Are you kidding me? If there ever was a society that the Word of God fits, it's this one. And it needs to listen to it. So he introduces himself to this particular church that has cast away, as it were, all of their ties to God, like Psalms chapter 2 says. He says, I am the verily and the so be it. I am the immutable one. I am the one who's the same yesterday, today, and will be forever. And listen, my word is the final authority, and not one jot nor tittle will pass away till it's all fulfilled. Psalms 139, I honor my word above my name, and you've set it aside. The faithful. I like that. The absolute trustworthy one. I've heard people say, well, you just can't trust God. So we have to trust our own thinking and our own philosophy. Listen, he's the faithful one. He's the true witness. He's authentic and he is accurate. And you better pay attention is the idea. The beginning. And that idea is preeminence. He has the preeminence in everything. You know, I love that prayer of Jesus in the Garden of Gethsemane. Look what he's modeling for us. That God's will is preeminent. It trumps everything else. Jesus saying to his Father. And I think it wasn't because of the beatings or the crucifixion that lay ahead of him. It was that separation. He said, if there is any other way, is there a plan B? But nevertheless, not my will, thine be done. You see, Christ needs to hold that place of preeminence in the church. I have a saying around here, and people will quote it often, that You know, you don't have a sin problem. Sometimes I do marriage counseling. People come in and are fighting with each other and doing all that kind of stuff. And you know, and I look at them and they say, well, how can you help us? And I say, well, you don't have marriage problems. We don't. Sure looks like we do. Well, no. You don't have marriage problems. You have lordship problems. Because are you loving your wife like Christ loved the church? Are you respecting and submitting to your husband as the church is to Christ? You see, everything that we get involved with that's involved with is not of the Lord is a lordship problem. And here they have a lordship problem because he is the beginning. He is the preeminent one, the first in rank and order. That's why we call him Lord. That's why we call him Master. You know, that's why Jesus said in Luke's Gospel, chapter 6, verse 46, why do you call me Lord, Lord, and don't do the things that I say? And this church had a form of religion, and it was saying that they were Christian, and there's a lot of churches running around taking on the Christian title. But listen, Jesus is not their Lord. And Jesus would ask that question of, why do you call me Lord, Lord? Why do you put Christian veneer and vernacular on your doors when you're not willing to give yourself totally into my absolute control? Again, my sheep hear my voice and they don't follow any other. Now, it's interesting when we come to Laodicea, he's going to mention some things and we're going to read it here in a few moments. In fact, let's read it right now and then we'll come back and tell you what this church was known for, this city was known for, known for four very prominent things. But let's pick up our reading there in verse 14 of chapter 3 of Revelation. And unto the angel or the messenger of the church of Laodiceans write, these things saith the Amen, the faithful, the true witness, the beginning of creation of God. I know thy works. And again, this is the word Oida. He knows the motivation. He knows everything behind what they're doing. He said, I know thy works, that thou art neither cold nor hot. I would that thou were cold or hot. So then, because thou art lukewarm and neither cold nor hot, I will spew thee out of my mouth. Because thou sayest, I am rich, and I increased with goods, and have need of nothing, and knowest not that thou art wretched and miserable and poor and blind and naked. I counsel thee, buy from me gold tried in the fire, that thou mightest be rich, and a white raiment, that thou mightest be clothed, and that the shame of thy nakedness should not appear. And anoint thine eyes with eye salve, that thou mayest see. For as many as I love, I rebuke and chasten. Be zealous, therefore, and repent. Behold, I stand at the door, and I knock. And if any man would hear my voice and open the door, I would come in to him. And I would sup with him and fellowship with him, and he with me. To him that overcomes, I will grant him to sit in my Father, in my throne, as also I have overcame, and I'm seated in my Father's throne. He that hath an ear, let him hear what the Spirit is saying unto the churches. There's some analogies used here as he is dealing with this particular church of Laodicea where people are in control, I think are noteworthy to bring to the fore. The first thing that this particular city, what this church was planted in, was known for, it was their wealth. Now get this. They were so wealthy that in 60 AD, when that city was leveled to the ground, I had a wonderful opportunity of being in that city. I got to visit it 2 years ago when I was up in Asia Minor, and they're just now unearthing a lot of the ruins. The Turkish government has employed some other governments to help with the expense, and they're doing a really neat archaeological dig there, and they're bringing everything to the fore. It's a beautiful city. But they were known for their wealth because in 60 AD, a major earthquake struck that area and leveled the city. And they being a free city of Rome, which meant that they were entitled to Roman imperial aid, that was offered to them, listen carefully, they refused and replied with these words, we have need of nothing. And so that city's nickname became the city. Listen, in this time, it became the city that had need of nothing. The second thing that's noteworthy about this city is the fine black wool that it produced, like no other region in the Roman Empire. In fact, they manufactured three types of garments, but the outer garment was the most sought after by the whole Roman Empire, and it was called the trimata, this beautiful black kind of a robe kind of a thing that you wore over, you know, in those cold winter days over there and at that time. And so they were known for this soft black wool. The third thing, interestingly, they're known for was an eye salve. There was a pharmaceutical university there in Laodicea, and there was a particular physician named Galen who had discovered and produced, actually perfected, this particular eye salve taken from a clay that was in that region. It was a Tephron Phrygia was the name of it, or Phrygian powder. You would take this particular clay as it dried, and you would grind it up into like a dust, add oil or water to it, apply it to the eyes, and interestingly enough, it had some success, and so they were known for this eye salve. But fourthly, they were known for aqueducts and water. As I stood there in Laodicea and I could look across the Lycus River Valley, you could see Hierapolis. We had just come from Hierapolis. In fact, we had just waded in the hot springs of Hierapolis, the mineral springs over there, and just spent some of the day over there on our tour in Hierapolis. But as we got to Laodicea, we didn't get to visit Colossae, but Colossae was over against the mountains, and you could see the snow caps, and there was a river that we were told that came down and some springs that were ice cold. And because Laodicea was a growing city and lacked water, they built an aqueduct over to Hierapolis to bring in that hot water from Hierapolis, and they built an aqueduct over to Colossae to bring in the cold water from that area. But the problem was, when it arrived, the hot water had turned tepid or lukewarm, and the cold water had turned tepid and lukewarm. And listen to what Jesus says, because there's no commendation to this church, only correction. He says, you're lukewarm. I've often heard it said that, you know, you're lukewarm, you should be hot, but God would rather have you to be cold so he can deal with you. That's not at all what it's saying here. What he's saying is, I wished you were hot, because then you would have a therapeutic effect on people around you. You would be healing and a healing balm to them. That when you interacted with this world, because you're walking in the Spirit and you're a representative of God's Word and of God's healing power and of God's grace and of God's mercy and of God's kindness and God's forgiveness, you should be hot. And you should be therapeutic as you interact with the world, but you're not. Secondly, I wish you were cold. What does that mean? Refreshing. On a very hot day, had one just the other day, I'm out working in the yard, and my wife brings me out a tall, ice-cold glass of water with a little lemon in it. That's how I like it. And every once in a while, she'll get me some of these mint little leaves and stick in there too. And man, I'm hot, I'm tired. You take a nice cool sip of that water, how refreshing it is, how reviving, as it were, it is. And when we come into contact with people, we should have that reviving effect, that refreshing, that bringing alive again effect. And Jesus says to this church, you are neither. You're neither therapeutic or refreshing. And because you're neither therapeutic or refreshing, I'm going to spew you out of my mouth. Now, when I taught this to our church, I got a little graphic. It's like, and I'll get graphic with you guys too. We're family. It's like blow chunks. It's like hurl. Not just regurgitate. You know, when my wife gets sick, she regurgitates. You know, she'll say, I'm sick. I got to go to the bathroom. And I'll hear this. And it's over. Are you kidding me? I sound like a cow dying in the bathroom because I'm hurling when I get sick. This is what Jesus said he's going to do. If you're not hot and cold, if you're not therapeutic and healing, and if you're not refreshing and reviving, then Jesus, I will spew you out of my mouth. Listen to the next correction, this false confession. And I think there's a lot of false confessions going on today in a lot of different churches. You know, we hear a lot today about the love of God. And that is one of his attributes, and I'm glad it is. It's a great attribute. God is love. But some of the churches are preaching because God is so loving, it doesn't matter how you live. That's not true. Or we hear a lot about sovereignty. You know, and God is so sovereign, He can choose some to be saved and some to be damned. Listen, if you buy into that false teaching of Calvinism, that's an assault to the character of God. Our God would never choose somebody to spend eternity in hell who wasn't part of the cause of that or never had a way out. That's preposterous. And they'll preach sovereign. God is holy. That's what we should preach. And the reason we know that that's the attribute we should use is because there are creatures that stand before His throne day and night and cry nothing but holy, holy, holy Lord God Almighty, who was, who is to come. You are holy and you are the same. You're immutable. There's no shadow of turning in you. And I think a lot of these churches that preach love or sovereignty, some believe if they preach sovereignty, if you're one of the chosen ones, you can never unchoose it. You'll always be chosen. Doesn't matter how you live. And the same with love. But listen, we want to serve the Lord. Yes, we are saved by grace through faith. That not of ourselves. It is a gift from God. And thank Him for that. But we are His workmanship, created in Christ Jesus unto good works, which He foreordained that we should walk in them. You cannot separate justification from sanctification. Because if you're born of the Spirit, you have a new heart. You put off the old man, you put on the new man. You walk in newness of life as the Spirit leads. Their false confession is, I'm rich. I increase in goods. I have need of nothing. But in reality, as the Lord looks at them, it's a whole different scenario, isn't it? When He looks at them, He says to them, you're wretched, you're miserable, you're poor, blind, and naked. You have a problem, but I have the cure for your problem. You see, His diagnosis is vastly different than theirs. As they looked around and said, look what we got going on, look what we got cooking here. All the things we're involved in, all the humanitarian things, you know, we're involved in. Listen, we are rich. We're increasing in goods. Look at the buildings we're in. Look at the things we're doing. And we don't have need of nothing. We don't need the Holy Spirit to lead and guide us. We don't need God's truth. Just look what we're doing. And so their opinion of themselves is vastly different than the reality and how God sees them. He says, you are wretched. You are miserable. You are poor, blind, and naked. And here's the cure. Listen again. Revelation chapter 3, verse 18 and 19. I counsel thee. Jesus is saying, I'm asking you to buy of me gold, tried in the fire, refined by the refiner's fire, that you may be rich, everlasting gold. Not the stuff that perishes here where rust and moth corrupt, but that which goes on into the kingdom of heaven. And a white raiment, not the black one from the black wool, although it's soft and comfortable, you need to have a white raiment that thou mayest be clothed, and that the shame of your nakedness does not appear. There's a garment, He says, I'm offering you, that if you wear it, listen, it covers all your shame and guilt, washed in the blood of Jesus Christ that you can wear. And anoint thine eyes with eye salve that thou mayest see the real eye salve. You know, it's like Paul there on the Damascus Road when his eyes were opened and he saw and he asked, who are you? And he said, I'm Jesus whom you're persecuting. And his response was beautiful. What do you want me to do, Lord? Buy from me, I said. And then he says this, and listen carefully, as many as I love. This is interesting. This is not agapeo. This is phalo. What he's saying, as many as I like. This is the thing that just breaks my heart about so many people caught up in religion. They know that the Lord, because He is love, will love them. But God likes us. I tell people around here, man, you know, it's not that God loves me, because I know He's love and He has to love me because He is love. But He likes me. He likes being around me. And Jesus said, as many as I like, I rebuke and I chasten. Maybe you're being rebuked and chastened as we're going through this message. Maybe you're far too religious. Maybe you're going through the motions without any emotion. Maybe you've gotten so busy with the work of the Lord that you have forgotten the Lord of the work. And you're about works and not about relationship. I would caution you. I'd put a pause on my life and I'd do some self-examination, because he says, I rebuke and chasten those that I like. He likes you. Even if you're messing up, he still likes you. He just wants you to come to repentance. He says this, be zealous therefore and repent. Listen, the cure for our messed upness is always repentance. Now let me tie a knot in this message. Very simple for me. As a pastor looking at the world today, I understand there are two things that are in existence today. Both are being called the church, but they are diametrically opposed to one another. One is an organism in relationship with Christ. The other one is an organization in relationship with men and their works. One is born of the Spirit. One is initiated by the flesh. And so as we come to this, there's a tale of two churches, but in the tale of two churches, listen, there are two doors. To the church at Philadelphia, he said, I give unto you an open door. First, an open door of access to me personally, to receive help, mercy, forgiveness, whatever you have need of. That door is open to you because you're the true church. Secondly, there's a door of ministry open unto you. Doesn't mean it won't be difficult, but I've opened a door that no man can shut of ministry as you preach my name and hold true to my word. It's an open door. And then one day there will be an open door in heaven and you'll be caught away. It's the church of the open door. It's a church that has a relationship, intimately so, with Christ, where he is our Father and we are his sons and daughters. And thirdly, listen, at the end of this thing, so it's the church of two doors, the church of two churches that we're going to see, and the church of two destinations. Because at the end of our life, the true church, we're going to hear some very remarkable words. I think, first of all, it's welcome home, because this ain't our home. But after he welcomes us home, he's going to say, now enter into your rest. Well done, thou good and faithful servant. I'm glad he didn't say, thou perfect and faithful servant, because I probably wouldn't qualify. But good, thou good and faithful servant. Two doors. First, the church of the open door. Two churches, the church of the open door and the church of the closed door, two different destinations. Listen to Laodicea, the church of the closed door. They have Jesus on the outside knocking, trying to get in. Isn't that interesting? The church of the closed door, Jesus on the outside. He's still banging away. He's trying to get in, but they got the door shut. Thirdly, when they get to heaven or stand before the great white throne, they're all going to be called up and resurrected. At that second resurrection, they're going to hear these words, depart from me, you worker of iniquity. I never knew you. Open door, shut door. Intimate relationship with Christ, him standing on the outside trying to get in. To hear those words on our final day when we take our last breath and are caught away into heaven. Welcome home. Enter into your rest. Well done, good and faithful servant. Or, depart from me, you worker of iniquity. I never knew you. Let me end with one final verse from from Kings. 1 Kings, I think I have it here somewhere. 1 Kings, where did I put it? Well, anyway, 1 Kings chapter... I think it's 18 says, I think verse 13. Isaiah is challenging the people. And he says to them, how long will you be between two opinions? See, there's two opinions before us. Either we're the church of the living God or we're just a church of religion. How long will you be between two opinions? If the Lord be God, then serve him. If not, then go serve the idols of this world. But you need to choose. We need to choose. I need to choose. I need to choose every day what church I'm going to belong to. The Church of Philadelphia, walking in the Spirit, born of the Spirit, led of the Spirit, or the Church of Laodicea, where man is in charge and in rule. God's Word being the final authority, or man? We have to choose. And I pray you choose rightly. I pray that you would never deny his name nor his word. And you would always hold to the fore that testimony of his suffering. That you would remain faithful to the end. These are trying times we're living in. I don't think it's going to get any easier. Again, our position when we go through eschatology is that we are pre-trib, but not pre-trouble. And I think there are some things coming down the road for us that are going to be challenging to our faith. Will you stand? Will you hear those commendations given to you that were given to the church at Philadelphia? I know your works. I know what it cost you to stand. I know that you only had a little strength, but you tapped into mine. I know you have not denied my word, and you have not denied my name, and you have not denied the testimony of my work on Calvary's cross. And he's going to say to us one of these days, well done. Amen? Let's pray. Father, we thank you again for this opportunity to speak to the church. Not a specialist, just a general practitioner, just a country pastor. But Lord, as I survey the world around us, I see two things that are becoming very, very clear. And the line of demarcation is becoming very defined. One is an organism, one's an organization. One is the true church of Jesus Christ, and one is the fake. One is the church of Philadelphia, and the other is of Laodicea. May, Lord, we always choose you. And we pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen.